Assalamu alaikum everybody. Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam ala rasulillah. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. Praise be to Allah, peace and blessing be upon his messenger, Prophet Muhammad, his family and his companion. Today we are going to continue with the prophetic family. We are going to continue with the noble family of the Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him. First of all, we have to say that all pictures of the prophetic family, peace and blessing be upon him, are not real photos. All the pictures of the Prophet's family are not real photos. Amr al-Ula Hashim ibn Abd Manaf. We're going to talk about Hashim ibn Abd Manaf, who is the second grandfather of Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him. Here is Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him. His father is Abdullah and his grandfather is Abdul Muttalib. And his second grandfather is Hashim. So Hashim is the second grandfather of Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him. Who is the third grandfather? Third grandfather is Abd Manaf, and the fourth grandfather is Qusai ibn Kilab. We talked about Qusai ibn Kilab, the fourth grandfather of the Prophet, and we talked about Abd Manaf ibn Qusai ibn Kilab, and we are going to talk about Hashim ibn Abd Manaf ibn Qusai ibn Kilab ibn Murrah. So Hashim ibn Abd Manaf is the progenitor of the ruling Banu Hashim clan of Quraysh tribe in Mecca. So this is Hashim, and all these are Banu Hashim. This forming the clan of Banu Hashim, which is one clan of Quraysh tribe. Quraysh tribe is about 9 clans. Hashim ibn Abd Manaf, born in Mecca in 464, and he died 497, so young, about 32 or 33 years. He died in Gaza, Palestine, which was called after him Ghazat Hashim. It is called Ghazat Hashim after him in honor of his name. Hashim ibn Abd Manaf. Hashim ibn Abd Manaf, his father is Abd Manaf ibn Qusay ibn Kilab ibn Murrah. Let's see, here is Hashim, the second grandfather of the Prophet, and his father is Abd Manaf ibn Qusay ibn Kilab ibn Murrah, who is Ishmael descendant of Prophet Abraham, peace and blessing be upon them. So his mother was Atikah bint Murrah ibn Hilal. Atikah bint Murrah al-Hulaliyya. Remember we said that Abd Manaf married several women of influential tribes. He among these women were Atikah al-Hulaliyya and Waqida al-Maziniyya. And we said this in the video of Abd Manaf ibn Qusay ibn Kilab. So his mother, the mother of Hashim, was Atikah bint Murrah al-Hilaliyya. So Hashim ibn Abd Manaf had two full brothers, Abd Shams ibn Abd Manaf and Muttalib ibn Abd Manaf. So these two full brothers from Abd Manaf and from Atikah al-Hilaliyya. And he also has half brother, whose mother was Waqida bint Amr al-Maziniyya. And this half-brother is Nawfal ibn Abd Manaf. So, and we talked about the birth of Hashim ibn Abd Manaf. We said that Hashim was born with one of his tooth pressed on the Abd Shams forehead, and the separation of the twins was so bloody. Remember, we said that Hashim and Abd Shams were twins, and the separation of the twins was so bloody. Hashim was born with one of his tooth pressing on Abd Shams forehead, and to separate the twins, some blood comes out, and we talked about this in the previous session. Okay. So when Abd Manaf, after Abd Manaf's death, let's see what happened. We talked about Qusay ibn Kilab, and we said that Qusay ibn Kilab gave all the Iktikaya, Rifada, Dar al-Nadwa, and Hijaba, everything he gave it to his son Abd al-Dar. And Abd Manaf respected his father's wish, and he focused on trade. And he left everything for his brother Abd al-Dar. But after Abd Manaf's death, when Abd Manaf died, his sons did not accept that all the matters of the Kaaba will be concentrated in the hands of their cousins Abd al-Dar. What happened? Sons of Abd Manaf, while assembled at the Kaaba, they refused this. They didn't like that everything in the hands of their cousins Abd al-Dar. So after Abd Manaf's death, they assembled at the Kaaba, and Hashim and his brothers and all their allies dipped their hands in a bowl of rich perfume with nutmeg powder and swore that they would never abandon one another. And rubbing their hands, their scented hands, over the stone of the Kaaba in confirmation of their pact. And Hashim and his allies were thereafter known as Hilf al-Mutayyibun. They make something like Hilf, like they swore that they will never abandon one another, and they dipped their hands in perfume and rubbed their hands in the stone of the Kaaba in confirmation of their pact, and they were known thereafter as Hilf al-Mutayyibun, the alliance of the sentient ones. And sons of Abd al-Dar. Sons of Abd al-Dar do the same. Their rivals, sons of Abd al-Dar, swore an oath of union and organized themselves into Hilf al-Ahlaf, and they known as the Alliance of the Confederates. So now Quraysh is divided. Now this clan is divided. So sons of Abd Manaf and sons of Abd al-Dar, both of them, as neither side wanted a full-scale conflict. So they start talking to the wise people of the tribe. They talk to the wise people of the tribe, or the wise people of the tribe talk to them, and neither side wanted a full-scale conflict. And they talk to the wise people of the tribe, and it ends with dividing the responsibilities. And they divide the responsibilities with As-Sikaya al-Rifada, two sons of Abd Manaf, and Dar al-Nadwa flag and Hijaba, two sons of Abd al-Dar. And sons of Abd Manaf, however, cast the lot for their charge, and consequently they left the charge of Sikaya and Rifada to Hashim ibn Abd Manaf. Hashim was accepted as the overall leader. So Hashim ibn Abd Manaf was accepted as the overall leader. He is leading he's responsible for of Sikaya and Rifada for the pilgrims. So he was accepted as the overall leader with the responsibility of Sikaya and Rifada for the pilgrims, with the support of his brothers Abd Shams and Muttalib, and his half-brother Nawfal. So Hashim ibn Abd Manaf was wealthy, honest, he was a merchant. You know, I told you that Qusai ibn Kilab gave everything to his son Abd al-Dar, while Abd Manaf focused on trade, and he formed a network with the tribes, and he excelled in trading, and he gave all his experience to his son, his elder son Hashim ibn Abd Manaf. So Hashim was merchant, and he was wealthy and honest, and he was very, very generous. He was the first to offer the pilgrims soaked bread in broth. His first name was Amr al-Ula. Hashim wasn't called Hashim. When he was born, his name was Amr al-Ula. But he was called Hashim because he had been in the practice of crumbling bread for the pilgrims. So Amr al-Ula was called Hashim because Hashim translates as pulverizer, or in Arabic, or the crusher, or the generous. After that, it was called generous because he was in the practice of crumbling bread in broth. So in Arabic, it means a generous one, because Hashim initiated and practiced crumbling bread in broth. So crumbling bread in broth that was later adapted for the pilgrims to the Kaaba in Mecca. And it was his practical compassion in 1 year of drought that earned Amr al-Ula his famous nickname of Hashim, the Crusher. This was because 1 year, when the people were starving and emaciated, Hashim provided food at his own expense for the entire population of Mecca. He fed the entire population of Mecca in this year of drought. In this year of drought, Hashim provided food at his own expense for the entire population of Mecca, personally fetching an immense stock of flour from Syria. He fetched immense stock of flour from Syria by camel caravan, and making bread, and then slaughtering the camels, and crushing the bread and meat to provide a soup kitchen for his people. That is why he was named Hashim, because he was very generous and he was in the practicing crumbling of food. They said he used to crumble food with meat and put it to the elder people in their mouth. So the old people who can't eat, he put the food to them in their mouth. He was very, very generous. Ibn Abbas said that Quraysh were experiencing the severity of hunger and poverty in some years, and some people may die of starvation without asking anyone. The Arabs, the people of Arabia, they don't ask anyone. They feel ashamed to ask anyone to give them something. So they may die of starvation without asking anyone. He said that when they were very hungry, the man would take his wife and his children and do i'tifad. 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 What is i'tifad? This means that they're going to a well-known place where they would hide until they die, one by one, without asking anyone. In the years of drought, they do this. When they don't find food, the man would take his family and go to a well-known place and hide in this place and look upon themselves until they die one by one without asking anyone. I'tifad is suicide. It's just suicide to get rid of the pain of hunger. This was the case until Hashim came to them. Hashim was a master in his people, and he was wealthy and generous merchant. He was very wealthy and very honest. Hashim had a son named Asad. And this Asad had a friend whom he loved and played with. One day his friend told him that they are going tomorrow to the hiding place to die, because they hungry, they no food, they own nothing, they don't have any food, and tomorrow they are going to the hiding place to die. Asad went to his mother crying for his friend. So she sent to those people meat and flour, which was enough for them for some days. After a few days, his friend came again and said, "We are going to i'tifad tomorrow." I'tifad means they are going to the place of hiding to die tomorrow. And Asad went to his father crying for his friend. So Hashim was very upset and he gave a speech to his people. He talked to his people. Oh, he said, "Oh, people, you have done something wrong. You have done something making you decrease in number, while the Arabs are increasing. This atifad, you are going this process where you're killing yourself. This makes you decrease in number, while the other Arabs are increasing. And this making you humiliating, while the other Arabs become happy, proud, and strong. And you are the best of Adam's son. You are the best of Adam's son. You are the people of the Haram. And all the Arabs come to the Haram and they are following you. You are the ones that are supposed to be followed by the other Arabs. And this atifad will end you. This process of atifad will end you. You have to stop it. They said, we are going to follow you. What to do? Tell us what to do and we are going to follow you. They love Hashim because, and in spite of his young age, they respect him, they love him. So they told him, okay, tell us what to do. He said, start with this man who is saying goodbye to you. Start with this man who is going to die. Help him, surround him, talk to him and support him. Help him to live and prevent him from atifad and stop this atifad forever. So they did what he asked them, and they prevent this man from atifad, and they stop atifad to follow what he told them. Hashim ibn Abd Manaf was held in much honor both at home and abroad. It was Hashim who first realized the potential for his family of taking part in the lucrative trade between Syria and Egypt, which passed through Arabia. Mecca is a barren valley, as you know, without cultivation, and as Allah described it in the Holy Quran, بِوَادٍ غَيْرِ ذِي زَرْعٍ. Mecca is a barren valley without cultivation. Trading was the most important means of livelihood for the inhabitants of Mecca. However, trading in Mecca was semi-local during the era of Qusai ibn Kilab and his sons, until Hashim came to them with the Ilaf. So, what is the Ilaf? The Ilaf, you heard about Ilaf in the Holy Quran. لإلاف قريش إلافهم. We will talk about it in Surah Quraysh. The إلاف is the covenant. They say it is the covenant. And At-Tabari says it is the infallibility and the treaties. So it is the infallibility and the treaties that ensured the conduct of the two great trade caravan journey of Quraysh from Mecca. So what is the Ilaf? The Ilaf was the great project of Hashim ibn Abd Manaf. The Ilaf was his great project. Hashim was the one who initiated and established the two great trade caravan journey of Quraysh from Mecca. The caravan of winter to the Yemen. He makes caravan of winter in winter to the Yemen. Start from Mecca to Yemen. And the caravan of summer to the north, from Mecca to the west of Arabia and beyond it to Palestine and Syria, which were then under Byzantium rule as a part of Roman Empire. Syria and Palestine were Roman colonies. His great project was to transport the Eastern goods to the West and the West goods to the East. This is the great project of Hashim ibn Abd Manaf. It is known that any great project faces huge challenges. So, and the great leaders must overcome these challenges successfully. Who bears the responsibility of transporting the Eastern goods to the West and the Western goods to the East? By wading into the dangerous desert wasteland. This is the first challenge. Who bears this responsibility? It's too difficult. So how could Hashim successfully overcome this huge challenge? The answer is simply in this word, partnership. So Hashim could successfully overcome this huge challenge by creating a perfect partnership. Hashim, with his intelligence, was able to persuade the Arab tribes to participate in this trade by providing security and contributing to the capital. So he persuaded all the tribes, or most of the tribes, to participate in this trade by providing security and contributing to the capital. Dr. Victor Sahab says, while the others were fighting, Mecca used to organize peace among the Arab tribes. Dr. Victor Sahab is the one, the author of the book Ilaf Quraysh, talking about the caravans of Quraysh, the caravan of the winter and the caravan of the summer. And he, in his book, he said that all the Arabs all over Arabia were fighting, but in Mecca, people of Mecca, people of Quraysh used to organize peace among the Arab tribes. So Hashim ibn Abd Manaf was an advocate of peace, not war. And he tempted the tribal elders. He talked to the sheikh of the tribes and he tempted them with prophets. So they agreed to participate in his project. So Hashim succeeded in convincing many Arab tribes. And this forced them to provide protection and security for the commercial caravans. And this forces them to provide protection and security for the commercial caravans. The danger was at that time in the first degree in the Bedouins, then in the Arab brats and lewd men. Dr. Victor Sahab says that the Bedouins, you know, I talked about the difference between the Arabs and the Bedouins, and you can review this video, please. What is the difference between Arabs and the Bedouins? A great difference between Arabs and the Bedouins. The Bedouins may not be Arabs, and there's a great difference between Arabs and Bedouins. And so Victor Sahab says that Bedouins were an important element in the economy of agricultural stability societies. So they used those Bedouins used to establish transportation through the desert, and they provided transportation, convoys, and armed guides. But in times of droughts, they may attack farmers, they may attack their fields, their livestock, and the pastures. And no one was able to deter them or prevent their raids. Those people used to make cheese and butter and sell them and buy in their place wine, flour, and grains. Hashim involved those people in the trade as gods to ward off their evil. So he used them as gods to ward off their evils. However, the tramps and the lewd men who were disowned by their tribes were living on stealing, plunder, and attacking people. And these were the only solution to confront them is the sword. So Hashim was focusing on security and safety a lot. He had to secure the caravan trade. Hashim was focusing too much on safety and security. So Hashim involved the tribes in the prophet and in securing convoys. As for the tribes that refused to enter the Ilaf, so those who refused to enter the Ilaf, they were paying them royalties. He used to give money to those people who refused to enter the Ilaf. He gave them money to help in protection. So as for the tribes that refused to enter the Ilaf, he used to give them money, paying them money for royalism. It was called al-Jal. This money was called al-Jal. This money or al-Jal was given to the sheikh of these tribes. This al-Jal or this money given to the leader of each tribe. It's called the sheikh. The leader is called the sheikh. And the sheikh of these tribes would return this money back to these convoys if they were unable to secure them. So Mecca had good relations with the tribes that are located in the way of the caravan. Also, Mecca, Hashim, was to be sure that there is good relation with the tribes that are located in the way of the caravan, either to Yemen or to Syria. So, such as these tribes, such as Juhayna, Mazin, Gaffan, Ghatafan, Ashja', Salim, Bani Asd, and Bani Asad. So, all these tribes, Mecca had good relation with these tribes, in the tribes which are in the way of the caravan. Quraysh gave the tribe of Tamim, for example, the functions of organizing the Hajj. And the tribe of tribe called Akili al-Marar, tribe of Akili al-Marar in Hadramaut in Yemen, were the allies of Mecca, and they were patrolling its caravans, and they were supporting them against other tribes. So Hashim was able to convince and support the parties for his project, this great project, which requires the transfer of the trade of the East to the West, and the transfer of the trade of the West to the East. Hashim laid a new foundation for the Meccan economy, taking advantage of a golden opportunity given by history, which is the absence of any middlemen in the global commercial arena. He set out to the power centers at the time to make deal with them, the power centers at that time. So he obtained first, this is Arabia, he obtained privileges from Ghassanid kings in Syria. So first he got to Ghassanid, the kings of Ghassan in Syria, and he got privileges from them. Then went in person to Byzantium. He went to Byzantium in person, and he procured an edict from Byzantine Roman Caesar. He procured an edict from the Byzantine Roman Caesar, exempting Quraysh from duties or taxes when operating in the countries under his domain. And the Caesar also wrote to the King Negus of Abyssinia to admit Quraysh there for trade. And Hashim's brother Abd Shams had a special permit with him. Muttalib had his treaty with the Hemirate of Yemen. Muttalib, their brother, also has his treaty with the Hemirate kingdom here in Yemen. And their half-brother Nawfal with the Persian government. He has his treaty with the Persian government of Iraq and Iran. So he commenced by going in person to Aden in Yemen. So he went to Aden in person, Hashim, in person to Aden in Yemen, to meet the ships coming from India, and purchased the stock, purchased all the stock coming from India and transported it to Mecca and then to Syria, Gaza, or Egypt. So this is his great project, is to get to go to, this is to make the caravan from Mecca to Yemen, to get the products from Yemen, which are coming from the east, and to take it and to transport it to here to Arabia and then to Syria and to Egypt. This is his great project, and he tried first by himself. There he brought up goods of local manufacture and brought them back to Mecca, mainly selling them at various Arab markets and fairs. Thus the Quraysh engaged in trade in Yemen and in Syria and also in Ankara, which allows them to flourish economically. And that's why Dr. Alois Springer, this is an Austrian Orientalist, described the Arabs as the founder of the world trade in ancient times. So, and Quraysh were so respected and popular that they felt no fear for their caravans being robbed or harmed along the way. And the various tribes did not even attempt to charge them the usual heavy transit tax they demanded from other caravans. Thank you so much. We are going to continue the next session. Thank you so much.